peak ridership appears to be 2014 to 2015, 1.5 million. Then it went to 1.4, 1.128, 1.182, went up a little bit last year. That's with two new routes. At the same time, we have seen cost per the cost per customer of RVTD go from $17 per customer in 2014 to what looks to be $32 a customer throughout those years. When you actually take the all funds and you divide it by your ridership, is there any passenger projections that have been made that say, you know, how we can justify continuing to go up 8.5, 8.7% a year, 8.5%? Is there any? I'm just looking for the justification of that. Is anybody, is there any studies done on that?
I don't know how you're calculating that, but you have to remember that first you have to throw out, first you have to realize that in 2014-15 we had increased service for the grant that we received for the expansion, and 15-16 we increased service, and once we cut that service, the ridership continued to kind of drop because people no longer had confidence in the service we were, and so it takes a while for that cycle to go back up. And
yeah, but the total expenditures continue to go up 8 to 8.5% each year, in spite of the fact that whether ridership went up or down. I'm trying to figure out, you know, where the.
So here's how it works: the less service, the more expensive it gets because you have fixed costs. And your fixed costs, if you can't spread them out over a large amount of service, mm-hmm. a little bit of service costs you more to put out there than a large amount of service. So that's part of it. And I also don't know how you're getting your figures, so I can't substantiate.
I'm taking your total expenditures and dividing into your yearly passenger counts.
Well,
simple.
The total expenditures include TransLink and capital projects and things that you kind of have to throw out of that.
No, you can't.
Yeah, because that is the cost of the taxpayer.
No. So TransLink is totally separate from the district. So you can't include the TransLink
right.
cost
and
because that's
yeah, Oregon Health Plan. Right.
It's Oregon Health Plan, and it's by a grant. Well, now it's through the CCO, so mm-hmm. the state of Oregon it pays in a pass-through situation with the coordinated care. And it is a cost neutral. So it doesn't cost the district any dollars.
But it does cost the taxpayers, though.
Yes.
No.
Well, yes, it does. It does cost the taxpayers money, not property tax money. But it does cost them tax money because it's part of the Oregon Health Plan.
Right, but I mean, we're not getting tax revenues from it. We're getting paid for each ride that we deliver a contracted amount. And that's like a $7 to $8 million budget, which you can't use the ridership from the fixed route and include TransLink in that equation.
Okay. I guess the final question is, do we have any passenger studies and projections of where we think it's going to go? We have two new routes now, and it looks like there's talk in Delta Union want to add another 33 employees, possibly.
So we do have passenger surveys that we do. We just finished one in February. Mm-hmm. And it tracks demographics, it tracks employment, and we saw a big increase in employment with our passengers, mostly part-time work. We asked if they have a full-time or part-time position, and we found that most of the jobs that our passengers have picked up have been part-time jobs. So they are using our transit system enough to get to those part-time jobs, but they're most likely not seeing an increase in their household income to afford a car.
Understood.
However, we have seen some passengers who have been able to get a better job, and good for them, that's fantastic, and probably rely less on our transit system and be able to purchase a car. We're not sure.
Okay.
We're kind of deducting what patterns we're seeing around the nation as well. We do have a model that we use. It's been calibrated based on parcel data with employment and residential dwelling units, and it uses algorithms that have been formed across the country based on people's affinities to use transit. And so when we model new transit service, we often have multiple options that we're looking at, and we'll kind of pit them against each other. We'll do a simplified alternatives analysis, if you've heard that terminology, where we look at alternatives and we analyze the different characteristics, including ridership. But part of what we also look at is low-income access to transit. If we're going into neighborhoods that are predominantly lower-income or older adult, people with disabilities, that kind of expansion going into geographic areas. So it's not just about ridership when we look at expanding service. It's often about access.
Do routes get justified by its ridership?
We look at the performance of routes typically after 3 years, because it takes approximately 3 years for travel habits to form around a new service. And we certainly do. We do provide information on how routes are performing before we ask for an expansion, for example, or adding frequency, so that we can invest in those routes that are seem to be performing the best. But I actually want to go back to the revenue source, because we do, I think that there's a large funding for TransLink that often gets mixed in, and there's a whole separate ridership for that across the Southwest Oregon area. That's not part of the 1.2, 1.3 million that is on our fixed route system.
Oh, so that doesn't include TransLink customers then?
That is just our regular fixed route system that you see running around town here. The TransLink ridership, I'm not familiar with too much because it's not my department, but it is separate from that. But when you streamline the budget and you look at just the basic services that we have, and we pretend that we have not received any capital grants for new buses, or facility improvements, for example, we're really looking at between $7 to $8 million. So the budget that we're looking at this year, and in some years, you'll see a large increase in revenue simply because we're getting capital funding. It doesn't happen every year. I think some of our staff wishes it would, and some wishes it wouldn't.
Agreed. I guess what I was getting at is that I understand, okay, I now understand, you know, take the TransLink, you know, out of that. Mm-hmm. But even then, I just wondering, you know, where, now I understand now you say that it takes about 3 years to establish new transportation patterns. So the two new routes are not going to reflect that favorably at this moment.
The 61 that goes to the RCC Table Rock campus, mm-hmm. Correct. That went in as more of a full-time route, because we were just doing it 4 times a day previously. And so now it's a full-time route. And that started in September with the academic year, because it mostly goes to the campus as sort of the purpose. The Route 21, we just started in April, and it was on a hiatus for a couple of years. And the Route 25, that goes to Southwest Medford, that one started in 2016. And so, you know, this coming year, we'll be doing it in September of 2016. So we'll be doing an analysis of that in the fall. It's actually performing pretty well.
I appreciate the explanation. Thank you.
Sure, absolutely.
Hi. Thanks for allowing the public to ask questions. We transparency. Appreciate it. I just want to dovetail on Board Member Ritchie's question regarding the supplies and materials. I know what supplies and materials are in general, but it went up 400,000, which is like a 58% increase. Are there any particular reasons why it's a 58% increase in materials and services? Quite a jump.
We got AC. To see once we get into the, you know, the by department type stuff. I mean, when it's off the line like that, it's kind of hard to see where the, because it's all like little tiny things.
I can wait and come back to the question if you'd like.
And I'll make sure I answer it as we go along.
I'll ask
just point out spots to you where there's a significant difference in what caused that.
Perfect, thank you.
All right.
What do you figure for per person basis, your benefits average out?
It's really hard to compare because, like I said, it depends on are you single or are you family. A family policy runs $2,700 a month. Mm-hmm. So So you can see that if you're on a family, it runs around $32,000 to $35,000 a year. If you're single, it's $1,800 just for the medical. You know, and it runs in the low 20s. So it's pretty hard to say per person, because we have employee and spouse, which is one step up from single, and then we have employee and children, and then we have family. Yeah, it's really hard to break it out.
Point 18 to 27.
Pardon?
Point 18 to 27.
Yes, yes, sir.